We are discussing the connection between the Langlands program and S-duality in four-dimensional super-Young-Mills theory. So last time I talked a little bit about the super-Young-Mills theory, and so the important thing here is that a four-dimensional n-equal form. And it is defined for a choice of a compact Lie group. We also have what's called a coupling constant. And oftentimes, this coupling constant is promoted to a complex number by introducing another parameter called the theta angle. And so usually you have something like this. This expression, complexified coupling constant tau. And the electromagnetic duality, which I already started talking about last time. Also called the S-duality of this super-Young-Mills theory is a statement that the gauge theory, or Young-Mills theory, n-equal 4 super-Young-Mills theory, was a compact Lie group G, comma C, and coupling constant tau is equivalent to another n-equal 4 super-gauge super-Young-Mills theory in which coupling constant is replaced by minus 1 over tau, and the compact Lie group is replaced by its Langlands 2. More precisely, there is a certain integer here, n, which is equal to 1, 2, or 3, so it's a basic number. It's 1 for all simplest Lie groups, and it is 2 for types B, C, and F, and it is equal to 3 for G2. And for instance, if theta is 0, this essentially means that the coupling constant gets replaced by its inverse. And last time I talked about the importance of this in the context of quantum field theory. Being able to relate the theory at the small value of the coupling constant to a theory at a large value, and as an indication of the existence of the theory beyond perturbation theory, which is usually how we approach quantum field theory as a perturbation theory in a small parameter. And then, of course, the Langlands dual group appears here. The Langlands dual of the compact Lie group. And this was the first indication when this duality was first proposed in the late 1970s by Montanin and Olle, following a work by Goddard, Knights and Olle. That was the first indication of possible connection of this duality to the Langlands correspondence and to the Langlands program. And indeed, such a link has been established very recently, in 2006, by Kapustin-Werden. And subsequent work in the past 6 years. So I already mentioned last time that the classical super-Young-Mills theory unfolds on the space of connections, essentially the space of connections on the Riemannian four manifolds. Here we consider what's called a Euclidean theory. So instead of a Lorentz group of symmetries, which should be the group of symmetries of a relativistic theory, we consider group SO4, or its double cover spin form. So we consider Riemannian, in fact, spin manifold. And we consider principal bundles over this manifold, with the structure. structure group GC, and we consider the spaces of connections on different equivalence classes of such bundles. Connections, T plus A. So the A become classical fields of the theory, but because we are considering the superextension of this theory, in fact, the maximum superextension of this theory, there are some additional fields that we have to introduce, as I explained last time. Additional fields. Essentially, there are two types of fermions, left and right, and there are also scalar fields, phi. So as I mentioned last time, the good organizing principle for this theory is actually to get it from a 10-dimensional superhelminth theory, an equal one superhelminth theory. So then that would explain the field content. So then you have an action, pieces of which I wrote last time, and then the next step is to consider quantum theory. In which correlation functions of various observables are represented by the path integral over the space of fields, of classical fields. That is connections A, fermions, lambda, lambda bar, and scalar fields phi, with insertions of these operators. Okay, so in this superextended theory, the Lorentz group, or SO4, or its Lie algebra, gets replaced by a super group, or super algebra, which I described in some detail last time. So now it has an even part, which is the original Lie algebra SO4, but now it has also an odd part, which is 16-dimensional. And the next step is to construct, to find a supercharge Q, which is an element of this odd part, which squares, whose anticommutator with itself is equal to zero, so essentially squares to zero, and such that it is invariant under the action of this even part, so that we can consider this supercharge on an arbitrary Riemannian manifold. And then the problem is that such a supercharge invariant under this algebra does not exist, and we have to do something to be able to find it. And so what we do is what's called the operation of twisting. And twisting means that we redefine an action. Find an action of SO4, the algebra SO4, on P1. And also then it would also mean that we redefine the action on the fields. The reason why we can do that is because there is an additional group of symmetries in the theory, which is a group SO6, the algebra SO6, the so-called R symmetry. The appearance of this symmetry can be traced to the derivation of this n equal 4 super Young-Mills theory in 4 dimensions from a super Young-Mills theory in 10 dimensions. So you have this additional 6 dimensions, and the group SO6 acting on those dimensions is the group of R symmetry. So we have to choose a homomorphism from SO4 to SO6. Here I'm talking about the level of Lie algebras. At the level of groups, you have to be more careful and study the corresponding double covers, the spin groups. And for each such homomorphism, you will obtain a new action of SO4 on this P1, and then you look for the invariant vectors. And so Kapustin and Witten have chosen a particular twisting. For which they showed there is actually a two-parameter family of such elements Q. So two linearly independent elements, which they call QL and QR, left and right. And so we can take a linear combination of these two with arbitrary coefficients U and V, and this element will satisfy the desired property, that it's square zero, and in addition, it will be invariant under this newly modified action of SO4, where SO4 will act through SO6, and through that will act diagonally, the old way, plus the action corresponding to the action of the R symmetry via this homomorphism. So of course, what matters is just this element Q up to rescaling. So essentially, there is one parameter, one twisting parameter, which is the ratio between them. Twisting parameter, which you could interpret as a point of P1, the projective line.
Just to set up the lambda, lambda bar, and phi, I assume that those have geometric quantum numbers that are fixed once and for all. What is the relation between the, I assume, internal quantum numbers coming from GC amongst the fields? If I pick an arbitrary GC, mm-hmm. how do they have to interrelate?
Well, these are, with respect to GC, they take values in the joint representation.
All of them?
Yes, all of them, but there's several copies. So for example, here there are six copies which correspond to the six-dimensional representation of SO6, because the group R symmetry also adds. So it actually decomposes with respect to GC, the Lie algebra of the compact Lie group of our gauge theory, and the group of R symmetry. So these guys correspond to, so with respect to GC, they are all in the adjoint. And this, for example, corresponds to a six-dimensional representation. This corresponds to the four-dimensional representation, because it's SU4, two spinner representations. So, okay, so now you choose this twisting parameter, and then we consider the theory with that twisting parameter. So now we have this operator Q, or if you will, Q sub T, and we consider the topological field theory corresponding to this element Q sub T. This I already explained last time. Topological quantum field theory. That it means that we focus, for example, when considering the correlation functions as written on that blackboard, we only look at those observables which commute with our operator. And then one can show that actually correlation functions then will only depend on the cohomology class of this operator. So in other words, operators which are in the image of this QT are going to give you zeros, they're not going to contribute to this topological sector. And so you're essentially considering just the correlation functions of cohomology classes, of QT cohomology classes, in the space of all fields. And this drastically reduces the space of fields. It reduces drastically the space of states as well, because what you are considering is the space from which the Hamiltonian ends by zero. So there's no dynamics. One can say that in some sense. It's trivial physically, but it is non-trivial mathematically. It is non-trivial physically as well, in some sense, because you can still study various quantities which are preserved by supersymmetry. For example, you can study boundary conditions. And there are many non-trivial boundary conditions which are preserved by supersymmetry variable QT. And so that leads you already to some very non-trivial statements just within this topological sector. And so, as I mentioned last time, a more familiar example of this is to consider an n equal 2 supersymmetric superimpedance theory. And Whitman has shown that, has constructed a twisting for that theory, in which he has shown that the corresponding correlation functions of these observables correspond to Donald's invariants. So this cohomology class, Q cohomology classes in that in n equal 2 theory. They correspond, the observables here correspond to some particular cohomology classes, which then you integrate over the modular space of instantons. Okay. So now we want to use S-duality in this context. And so we want to consider two theories like this, two topological theories like this, for two groups, for the group G. GC and the lambda is dual for particular values of this parameter T. And so the values which we will choose will be that here T will, under this S-duality, Kapustin-Witten showed that this twisting parameter transforms in a certain way. And so in particular, we are interested in the case when T is equal to I, and TL, twisting parameter of this theory is equal to I, and this one is equal to I. And also the theta angle, which I mentioned, which could be used to come, as a parameter, is set to zero. So this is a particular example of this. And then we can talk about generalization and deformation, but let's just focus on this particular example. So we look at this case, and we know that these two theories Now, two topological quantum field theories have to be equivalent. Expect these two theories to be equivalent to each other. But these are still four-dimensional theories. And so we couldn't see right away any possible link to the geometric Laplace correspondence, which unfolds on Riemann surfaces, as we discussed. So the first step that they do is they pass from this four-dimensional superangular theories to some two-dimensional supersymmetric quantum field theories. And this is done by a standard trick of what's called dimensional induction. What it means is that we consider a special case when our four-manifold M4 is a product of two-dimensional manifolds, of two Riemann surfaces. And we consider the limit of our theory in which the size of x is much smaller than the size of c. So in this limit, the theory reduces four-dimensional theory, super young Mills, with this delta, reduces to a two-dimensional quantum field theory, supersymmetric quantum field theory, defined on the large one, on the large platform, on sigma, defined on sigma. And so the question is, what is the theory? In fact, this question was asked about 10 years before the work of Kapustin-Witten by two groups, by Ryshatsky, Johansson, Sadov, and Waffa, and also by Moore, Harvey, and Stroninger. And they have shown already that they were able to describe what this two-dimensional theory is. And they said that this is actually going to be the sigma, what's called supersymmetric sigma model. Supersymmetric sigma model. With a target manifold. So it's a theory on sigma. Target, which depends on x. So let's say if we start with super young Mills theory with a gauge group GC, and we get a sigma model with a target manifold which I denote like this. So this theory describes maps from sigma to a certain moduli space, which depends on x and on g. Sometimes I will abbreviate it as just mh of g, and so that x will be understood that it's already defined in x. And this is a so-called Hitchian moduli space. H is, it can be taken for Hitchin or for Higgs. It's convenient that it kind of covers two names. I will explain what this is. Right now it sounds kind of mysterious. Okay, so you have some young gauge theory, and suddenly somehow you get maps from here to here. But actually, it's not very mysterious. The derivation is quite straightforward. So, what are the steps of the derivation? First of all, recall that we are now in the framework of the topological field theory, right? And so in the topological field theory, there are two simplifications. The first simplification is that we are restricting ourselves to the closed observables which commute with the supercharge. And in fact, then actually we reduce to the cohomology. And the second simplification is that the path integral, which I wrote on that blackboard, which is an integral over infinite dimensional space of fields, reduces to a finite dimensional moduli space. Or more precisely, it reduces to a disjoint union of components which correspond to different Bajorian classes, the different topological types of bundles, since we are considering connections on bundles. And each of those components is actually finite dimensional moduli space, which is kind of very similar to the moduli space of instantons. how do we get this moduli space? Very simply, we impose the conditions that QT, so we just mode out, so to speak, all fields by those fields which are in the image of the supercharge. So if you want to say the bosonic part of this moduli space, you would just apply this to the fermions that you have in your theory, lambda, lambda bar. So you will get some expressions which are going to be expressed as some partial differential equations on the bosonic fields. And then you set them equal to zero. So you get a system of partial differential equations. So in the case of n equal to 2, for example, Young-Mills, which is related to Donaldson, the reason it is related to Donaldson theory, as shown by Whitman, is because that this way, this equation gives you precisely the anti-duality equation. So you get the moduli, so Fa equals star Fa. So you get the moduli space of instantons. In this case, as Kapustin with the show, it's not a moduli space of instantons. The equations are more complicated because the equations will now involve bosonic fields which are now of two kinds. There is this the connection, and there is also this field phi. The field phi originally starts its life, in untwisted theory, starts its life as a scalar field. So the phi corresponds to functions with values in the adjoint representation, and also there are six copies, as I mentioned. But actually, because we are twisting now, what's going to happen is that four components of this phi are going to become one forms. And the remaining two components are going to remain scalars. You see? So you're getting certain equations which mix A and phi, and they also depend on the twisting parameter T. So you get the system equations. Okay, so now we get this. Now we are trying to do this dimensional reduction. And we are saying that the size of X is much smaller than the size of sigma. What does it mean? It means that we are saying that the degrees of freedom along sigma are the slow ones. So in the limit, when the size of X goes to zero, we can ignore the derivatives with respect to those degrees of freedom. Then all the fields still depend on the coordinates on sigma, but the equations will only be differential equations with respect to the degrees of freedom on X. And so we get the dimensional reduction, the standard dimensional reduction of the system of partial differential equations with four variables to a system of equations for two variables. And the equations we get, they look as follows. So it will be equations on A and phi. More precisely, I will write the equations on A and the four components of phi, two components of phi which live along X. And the way other components enter the story is a little bit more tricky, and I will postpone it till later. And so the system will look something like this, schematically. I'm using a different font for phi now, but maybe I should write that. So this is a curvature, minus phi, which phi is zero. This is a covariant derivative corresponding to the connection on phi, and this is a Hodge star operator. So you get the system of equations. And then lo and behold, we look at this equation, and we recognize the equations which were studied by Hitchin. Nigel Hitchin has studied the system of equations in the 80s. He has shown that the system of equations can be describes a very natural moduli space associated to X. These are the equations on X. But remember, we still have our slow variables, which are go along sigma. Okay? And so when we reduce the theory, our fields are still going to depend on those sigmas. So the derivative will not enter, but it will still depend. And so the sort of the ensemble which solves these equations in that limit will correspond to a map from sigma to a solution of these equations. So that's how we get this. This is how we get the description of the reduced theory. So it's a very straightforward, sort of a very straightforward argument in which the crucial step is, first of all, well, writing the PDEs, defining the topological theory here, and then doing a dimensional reduction of the system of ideas, and then realizing that what we get is actually the Hitchin moduli space. Now, the beauty of this moduli space is that it has analytic description. And in fact, it defines a hyperkernel manifold, which is very interesting. And that's what is denoted by MH of XG. Okay? So let's talk about this. Let's talk a little bit about this, this hyperkernel manifold. So actually, Dave Beyer gave me this amazing chalk that he got from Japan. I don't know if you noticed, but I'm not covered in chalk. You normally, by this time, I'm completely covered in chalk. And maybe you are too, at least the ones who sit in the front row. But, and also, it is amazing because this is the chalk which I started using at the beginning of last lecture. And I still about halfway through. But he just gave me a box. So if anyone is interested, I can continue this. So this is really, I highly recommend it, but then he said that he cannot really buy it, so he had to some tricks to get it. So I'm really happy that I have now some supply. So I could give one to somebody. So. We can discuss later. Okay. So what is this moduli space? So this moduli space is actually hyperkähler. Is that it has a whole P1 of complex structures, and usually there we say that there are three structures corresponding to point 0, 1, and infinity, and so they're usually called I, j, and k, and there's sort of a standard terminology by now here. So in complex structure I, this is the moduli space of semi-stable Higgs G bundles. What is a G? What is a Higgs bundle? Higgs bundle is a pair E and phi, where E is a principal G bundle. By the way, perhaps I should have said that, but now by G, I denote the complexification of this compact. So say here, if I start with SUN, this will be SLNC. So it's a principal holomorphic G bundle. And phi is a one-form, is a holomorphic one-form, which is valued in the adjoint bundle. So precisely, is a full-length gadget. So GE is just the adjoint vector bundle, so it is just corresponds to E and the adjoint representation. Also, sometimes you write it as add E, maybe R small E. This is a canonical line bundle. So this is really a differential, homomorphic differential with values in this adjoint bundle. And there is a notion of, as we already discussed before, the fact that when you study bundles, principal G bundles on Riemann surfaces or complex algebraic curves, there isn't usually an algebraic variety which parameterizes those bundles, but there is an algebraic stack. So here we also can consider algebraic stack. What naturally appears, though, is not algebraic stack. What appears is the moduli space of solutions of this PDE. And this moduli space actually turns out to be somehow to parameterize not all Higgs bundles, but only semi-stable ones. So what does it mean, semi-stable? So there's a certain stability condition. And first, you introduce this stability condition on bundles, on principal bundles. So I will not go into details, but let's just say, for example, if G is SL2, you can think of E as a rank 2. Vector bundle such that its determinant, together with the trivialization of its determinant, determinant of E. And in this case, we will say that E is stable if it does not contain line subbundles of non-negative degree. And we say that it is semi-stable if it does not contain line subbundles of positive degree. So that's the notion of stable and semi-stable SL2 bundles. And what about Higgs bundles? Now you have a bundle, and rank two bundles, say, and also this 1-4, right, this Higgs field. So then the stability condition extends, but we only consider lines of bundles which are phi stable, which are phi invariant. So maybe I put square brackets, and then here square e phi. Okay, so you have this notion. So there is a generalization of this to other types. So you're considering pairs, bundle with a connect, bundle with a 1-4, not yet connections. That will come next when I talk about couple structure change. But you impose some conditions, and Hitchin's result was that this exactly gives you this moduli, the space of solutions. So there's a subtle point here, which I'm kind of jumping over, which is that it really parameterizes stable. The points, the solutions of the system of equations, more precise, are either stable bundles, stable Higgs bundles in this sense, or equivalence classes of semi-stable Higgs bundles. So there is some identification among semi-stables. The set of points is not the set of equivalence classes of all semi-stable bundles, but rather set of equivalence class of stable ones plus some the semi-stable modulus some additional relation, which I'm not going to give. Okay. So that's a very beautiful, very precise, and very algebraic description of this what appears just as a set of solutions of some differential equations. So now we actually get something description of it as points of an algebraic variety, of a moduli space. This moduli space is usually singular. So for instance, in the case of Vessel 2, it will actually be singular. Okay. Now, what about this, the other complex structure? Complex structure J. In complex structure J, we get objects which are more familiar, objects which we have studied before, namely flat bundles. In the complex structure J, this appears as the moduli. This is a moduli space of semi-stable. I want to say again semi-stable, although it could be better to say semi-simple, maybe. Simple. Flat bundles. So now, an object is not, it's a pair, a bundle, and a connection. So E is, again, as before, but Nabla is a holomorphic connection. So I should have said, maybe, that X is assumed to be compact. It's a compact Lyman surface. We don't assume that for sigma. In fact, we will be interested in the case when sigma this other Riemann surface has a boundary, but X is compact. And so it's an algebraic curve, smooth and compact. So it's a smooth algebraic curve. And so here the notion of holomorphic connection says the same as the notion of algebraic connection. So this is exactly kind of a gadget that we discussed in the framework of the Langlands correspondence. And of course, it looks very similar to Higgs bundle because the set of holomorphic connections on a given bundle is a torsor, or principal affine space. Affine space, principal homogeneous space, for the space of one forms. So they look like similar, but there is no canonical identification, right? Because to be able to find canonical identification between connections and on a given bundle and one forms, you have to choose a reference connection. Then you can take the difference, it will be an honest form. So maybe I will write this like this. Nabla minus Nabla prime is going to be, is like phi. But in general, there isn't such a choice. So the fact that this moduli space of flat bundles is actually isomorphic to the moduli space of Higgs bundles, provided we impose the semi-stability condition, comes as a surprise. And in fact, because as I said, these are two descriptions of the same moduli space. So you have this hyper-Kähler manifold, and there are two descriptions. So you can turn this around and say there are two moduli spaces, and they're isomorphic to each other. But the isomorphism is not algebraic. It is these two moduli spaces are not isomorphic as complex, even analytic as complex manifolds. They are isomorphic as just as real manifolds, as real analytic manifolds. And this isomorphism of the two structures is very important. More so for two structures. Very important is referred to often as non-abelian Hochstein. In addition to Hitchin, who has studied this in great detail, other important work has been done by Simpson and Corlette and Donaldson and others. So this is a very beautiful story, very deep and rich story behind this moduli space. And now, lo and behold, this moduli space shows up when we do the two-dimensional reduction of this four-dimensional Super-Young-Mills theory. And what we would like to do is to explore the consequences of S-duality for this two-dimensional reduction. So under S-duality, as I explained, the group G on one side gets replaced by its Langlands dual group, right? And so in the framework of the four-dimensional super-young males. And so the same will be true also for these two-dimensional reduced theories. So S-duality gives rise to the equivalence of sigma models, of two-dimensional sigma models, on one side, those corresponding to maps from sigma to the moduli Hitchin moduli space associated to the Langlands dual, and on the other side, the sigma model corresponding to maps from sigma to the moduli space, Hitchin moduli space associated to the group G. And in fact, what we really want to understand is the implications of this duality for the corresponding topological theories. Topological theories meaning that we're only interested in things which are preserved by the supersymmetric charge Q. And this supercharge Q, as I explained, actually there are two different values. So for this QT, so it depends on this parameter T, right? And so here, the value here is T equal 1. If I got my math right. Now here I want to take I, and here it's going to be, so it's LT, and this I want to be equal to. And then so these two values correspond to the very different supercharges, and you get very different types of topological quantum field theories. And in fact, what we get here are two-dimensional theories of two different types. One is called the B model, and the other one is called the A model. So this is going to be the so-called A model. And this will correspond to this particular value T of T. And this will be B model. And the equivalence between them that we will get is actually what is familiar to us mathematically as mirror symmetry. It's mirror symmetry between these two manifolds. So now, what does it mean that we consider B model and A model? So the two different types of topological theories, very much like we discussed topological theory in context of the four-dimensional theory. Now, very much similar. That is, you have to choose a supercharge. You have to do twisting, and you have to do a supercharge. These are two different twistings, two different ways to, and each twisting distorts the action of the Lorentz group. Or its Euclidean analog, which in this case will be SO2, distorts its action on the fields and sort of gives them different quantum numbers, so to say, in the sense that in one case it will get differential forms, in the other case holomorphic forms, and the supercharges will then be interpreted as a Durham operator, as a Durham differential in this model, and as a Dalbeau operator in this model. So here the supercharge becomes a Dalbeau operator, and that's already an indication that what this topological theory depends on is a complex structure on the target manifold. So it depends on the complex structure. And then, of course, we have to say which one, because I just told you that this is a hyperKalman manifold, so it has whole P1 of complex structures. And so this will actually correspond to the complex structure of J. So here, this moduli space will appear as a moduli space of flat bundles with its natural complex structure coming from that description. I mean, if once you describe it as a moduli space of some objects on this complex algebraic curve X, this naturally gives you a complex structure. And so that's the complex structure J, which shows up here. Whereas in the A model, the supercharge becomes the Durand differential. And actually, it turns out that the A model really depends on the symplectic form, which, well, in the case, we are considering a complex manifold. So it's actually going to be a Keller manifold. It will depend on the Keller class of this form. So in the symplectic form here, is what's usually referred to as omega k, and it is you can define it as the imaginary part of the natural complex symplectic form, which I will just I'll talk about in a minute. So these two manifolds should be a dual mirror dual manifolds, and the A model is the symplectic form with respect to the symplectic form, and the B model with respect to this complex structure are going to be equivalent to each other as topological quantum field theories. Now, what is symplectic form? So, the point is that actually MH is a complex symplectic manifold, or more precisely, the smooth locus of it. It has singularities, so you have to be careful. Let's just say, if you take the open dense part of smooth locus, it's going to be a complex symplectic manifold. And the way you see that is that I recall that phi is really this Higgs field is a section of this vector bundle, which is, and then you have to realize that this is actually isomorphic to the cotangent bundle to E in the corresponding modulus of G. So very roughly speaking, this MH of G is a cotangent bundle to bund G. This would have been true if we were studying the moduli stack of Higgs bundles, where somehow all the Higgs bundles would be allowed. But we have to qualify this now, because now we are imposing the stability condition. So what is true is that inside this moduli of semi-stable Higgs bundles, there is a locus of which is a cotangent to the moduli of stable Higgs bundles. And on the moduli of stable Higgs bundles, we can do this trick and say that it's just a cotangent bundle. So we have a symplectic form. And then the point is it actually extends further to the smooth locus of the moduli of semi-stable Higgs bundles. But this you can see quite clearly via the shared duality. By shared duality, this is dual to G. Well, if I put here a star, I put a dual here, then this is going to be H1 with coefficients of dual. And this is the tangent by the usual Kader-Spencer argument. This is a tangent space, whenever it is well defined. This is a tangent space. So I'm considering now the smooth point E of a moduli space. So say a stable bundle. And you see, the dual by shared duality, we have this isomorphism. But now, it is in all the discussions implicit that G is actually a simple group. So G is a simple algebra. And, then it says there's a unique way to identify this with the corresponding, the dual, to identify it with just with the bundle GE. Well, even if it's reductive in general, for general compact, there's not a unique way, but there is a way to identify, right? So we can identify this with G. So we have to choose an inner product. So the inner product is kind of lurking in the background here, but it's kind of harmless here. So in any case, it's isomorphic to this. And so this phi, this additional parameter, takes values really in the cotangent space. And so what we're dealing with is very close to the cotangent bundle, which carries a canonical holomorphic symplectic form. And what we take here is its imaginary part. Okay. So now, what are the implications of this mirror symmetry? So remember, we started out with S-duality. of the four-dimensional super young males for the groups G and Langlands duo. We have done this dimensional reduction. And we are now looking at the topological sector of the resulting two-dimensional theory, so they are equivalent to each other. So everything that we can say about one of the theory on the right-hand side should have an equivalent, an analog on the left-hand side. And so what we originally, in the study of mirror symmetry, what mathematicians have been mostly interested in is the spaces of, what one can say, the space of vacuum states. In other words, the spaces of vacuum states of the corresponding quantum field theories, which are essentially just the spaces, subspaces of the spaces of states of the corresponding quantum field theories on which the Hamiltonian acts by zero. So that's what we call the vacuum. And these vacuum states are described by certain cohomologies. In the A model, because the supercharge is a Durand differential, it's described by the Durand cohomology. In the B model, because the supercharge is a Dalbo differential, it's described by Dalbo cohomology. So it's described by the Hodge numbers. The dimensions of these cohomology spaces are described by the Hodge numbers. And of course, for a long, you know, one of the exciting developments in mathematics, I guess, in the early 90s, was the realization that exists this pairs of mirror dual, mirror symmetric Calabi-Yau manifolds for which you have these unexpected relations between their cohomology classes. Now, what is closer to this discussion is actually work by our very own Michael Thaddeus and Tamás Hausel, who looked at this pair of, for the first time, they looked at this pair of manifolds as mirror dual manifolds. And they have looked at the corresponding spaces of vacuum vectors and established the corresponding isomorphisms of the cohomology spaces, the quality of the dimensions of the cohomology spaces. So this is one of the predictions of this mirror symmetry. One of the predictions of the mirror symmetry is the isomorphism of the relevant spaces of vacuum vectors. Certain cohomology spaces. Cohomology spaces. Of the two moduli spaces. And this is easier said than done because, well, there are many complications here actually, which I'm kind of sweeping into the rug. First of all, they are non-compact. You have to be careful what you mean by the cohomology. But that's not all. They also have singularities. Right? And there is one more issue, which is that to really do justice to this mirror symmetry, you have to also realize that you have to introduce what's called a B field. And so what happens here is that, for instance, if the group is SLM, say G is SLM, then you only have one component for this modular space. But the dual group is PGLM. And then you get components which are labeled by integers modulo n. So say for SL2, you have PGL2, you have two components. And under this mirror symmetry, you can ask, how is it possible? Here you have two manifolds, and here you have one. So they cannot be dual. Two cannot be dual to one. The trick is that what replaces the components here on this side is the appearance of gerbs. So what Fiss would call a V field. But mathematically, which correspond to the appearance of certain gerbs, in this case, GM, really U1 gerbs or GM gerbs over this moduli space. And so you have to correct the corresponding cohomology theory by a gerb to really do justice to mirror symmetry, including all components. So this is what Hausel and Thaddeus have done. Now, I have to say that what they did really is slightly different because in their case, they considered the duality of two B models. So they were really considering Dalbo cohomologies on both sides, or suitably defined sort of stringy Dalbo cohomologies, Hodge numbers on both sides. And so this might come as a surprise because we are most used in mathematics to the duality mirror symmetry between A model and B model. And in fact, I think maybe in their paper, maybe it was one of the first examples in mathematical literature where people essentially saying, well, look, you actually can have also mirror symmetry between two B models. But that's something which is not unexpected. I mean, you can have an equivalence of two B models in two-dimensional quantum field theory, and especially if you work in the context of of this hyper-Keller manifolds, then that's quite a common occurrence. And so so what they did is actually they studied the mirror symmetry of the two moduli spaces or the two sigma models, but with respect to the B models for the B model, B models on both sides, J, the complex structure J, for both of these. But their analysis actually has very important implications for the study also of the duality, which is now relevant to our discussion, which is the duality between the A model and B model. Okay? And the most important element of their analysis is their realization that this mirror symmetry can be phrased in the framework of what's called the SYZ mechanism, or SYZ picture. For SYZ, for Strominger, Yao, and Zaslow. So their idea is that mirror manifolds oftentimes can be realized as special Lagrangian vibrations over the same base. So in other words, in this particular setting, that would mean that these two manifolds, these two moduli spaces, can fiber over the same base, let's call it B, so that the fibers, or at least smooth fibers, are what's called a special Lagrangian toroid. Special means that, well, since it's hyperkeller, it's actually Calabi-Yau, then you have the holomorphic top form. And so the restriction of this holomorphic top form to the fibers equal to zero. That's what special Lagrangian means. Special Lagrangian toroid. And so the idea of Housel and Tadius was that you can construct, you can produce families of special Lagrangian toroid using precisely manifolds like this, using hyperkeller manifolds, and using the fact that it has two different complex structures. So one is the complex structure which you're considering, and then you use the other complex structure to construct a family of Lagrangians, but not special Lagrangians, but rather holomorphic Lagrangians. So in our case, that second complex structure would be the complex structure I, which I talked about on that board. And we can employ this complex structure I, in which MH of G appears as a moduli space of Higgs bundles. We can employ it to construct this vibration. And in fact, this was one of the important results obtained by Hitchin. Hitchin said, basically, how do we construct holomorphic functions on this moduli space of Higgs bundles? So let's suppose you have Higgs bundle, or Higgs pair. So I recall that phi here is an L is a holomorphic one form with balanced with adjoint bundle. So if I have a function P on the Lie algebra, and when I write fun, I mean algebraic function, regular function. So you have a polynomial function on this Lie algebra. You can substitute phi into this function. Well, but this would be the case if you actually had the section of a trivial bundle. But here you have a non-trivial bundle, which is like this vector bundle, which is twisted by this E. And so the only way that this would make sense is if this function is invariant under the adjoint function. Because basically you choose a trivialization of this bundle and you evaluate this. If you change the trivialization, it will change by the action of G. But if your function is invariant, you'll get the same result. So this way, you're going to get an element. So let's say if it's a homogeneous function of some degree D. And this will be, we'll have to raise to that degree the canonical line bundle also. So we're going to get a section of the canonical line bundle to this, to the dth power over x. Right? And so now we know that this algebra is actually a polynomial algebra in some elements P1, PL, where L is the rank of G, and the degree of PI is the exponent, ith exponent plus 1. So for instance, the first exponent is always 1, so there's a quadratic element, and then there will be higher degree elements. Say for SLM will be means of degree 3, 2, 3, 4, and so on up to n. And now we get a map now from M H of G. We get a map to the direct sum of the spaces for which D takes values specified here. So you get X is coefficient here, X tensor D I plus 1. Right? Namely, you have, if you're given a pair E phi, and you simply take P1 of phi, etc. So now to get a function, you simply take any linear function on this vector space, and you're done. So you're going to get a normal function, a holomorphic function. And so then actually remarkable fact is, let's suppose that the genus of the curve is greater than 1 to avoid various complications. So you can actually count this dimension by Riemann-Roch very easily, and you find that it's exactly half of this dimension. And moreover, I told you that this actually has a symplectic structure, and you actually find that all of these functions that you get in this way, by taking the composition of this map to, this is a vector space, to, you can take a map, any linear function on it, and you get a map to C. All of these functions Poisson commute with each other. So you actually get a maximal Poisson commutative subalgebra in this algebra. And actually, the whole algebra, you can show then that, because actually you can show that this map is proper. And so that, in fact, the algebra of holomorphic functions on this moduli space with respect to complex structure I. I remind you that this description appears in the complex structure I. And you get a maximum Poisson commutative subalgebra. This is what's called the completely integrable system. And honestly, we can say algebraically completely integrable because all of these functions are algebraic. And it's integrable by Liouville, which means that the generic fibers are going to be tori. And they're going to be complex tori with respect to the complex structure I, and they're going to be Lagrangian with respect to the corresponding complex symplectic structure. And so then, Hausdorff and Tadros say, wonderful, let's use this guy, so let's call this B. Let's use this B, this vector space, as a base. And now let's also observe that this algebra, there is an isomorphism between this algebra for G and for its Langlands dual, which, well, it depends on the choice of an inner product, but in a harmless way, which can be done away by using rescalings, for example, in the case of simple D groups. So the two bases, B and LB, for the group G and for the group Langlands dual are actually isomorphic. So we might as well just think of them as a single base, and then we got two vibrations from the moduli spaces associated to G and the Langlands dual G, right, over this, which are vibrations of complex Lagrangian tori with respect to complex Lagrangian for I, the complex structure I. And then the argument of Hausdorff and Tadros is that, well, then they give us precisely what we want, the special Lagrangian tori for the complex structure G. And so we get into the Sturm-Jahn-Zaslow picture. Because Sturm-Jahn-Zaslow said that you should be able to realize mirror symmetry in many cases, two mirror manifolds, as such vibrations. And then the point is that here you get tori, so you get a vibration of tori, and here you get a vibration of tori. And tori are the manifolds for which we know what mirror symmetry does. The mirror dual of a torus is a dual torus. Okay? And so then the idea is, okay, so if you know it for tori, so it's like a abelian case in some sense. So then how do you describe mirror symmetry for more general manifolds which are not tori? So it's not kind of non-abelian case. Well, the idea is, okay, let's suppose that we can represent them as toric vibrations over the same base. Then there will be a fiber-wise duality between them, between, you know, those fibers, and then therefore this is what will give us the duality of the two manifolds. So now, what do I mean by a dual torus? What do I mean by dual plus? So, actually, I want to keep this. But if you have a torus on this side, so that, actually, let me reproduce the picture here. So here, you have some point B, and so here you'll have a fiber, which I'll call FBL, right? And then here, over the same B, I will have the fiber. Maybe let's make it symmetrical. It's like this. Here you'll have a fiber, which we'll call FB. And so generically, these two guys are tori. And they're dual in the following sense, that F, this one is the moduli space of flat unitary line bundles on the other one, and vice versa. So each point of this guy, each point in here, let's call it E. So E is a flat LG bundle, because remember here we're actually considering the complex structure J. And in the discussion of Hausdorff titles also we consider complex structure J. So let's say a point E which falls to this point on the base under this map, under this Hitchin map. Then this one will actually give rise to a line bundle, a unitary line bundle and a unitary connection. So flat unitary line bundle. And vice versa. But let's remember this because this will be useful to us in a moment. Okay? So that's what this mirror symmetry does. And as I said, one of the first results that you want, corollaries that you get, is you look at the corresponding spaces of vacua, you define them in certain cohomology spaces, suitable cohomology spaces, and then lo and behold, they turn out to be isomorphic to each other, as Hausdorff and Titus have shown. What else can we do? What are the other implications of this mirror symmetry? Because after all, mirror symmetry, as I said, is a much bigger statement. It's a statement that two quantum field theories, two topological quantum field theories, are actually equivalent to each other. So what Kapustin and Witten did is they applied this mirror symmetry to the so-called categories of brains. So in addition to the spaces of vacua, you can also attach to each of these theories the so-called space of brain, categories of brains, or categories of boundary conditions. The notion of the brain comes from the concept of a boundary condition. So, okay. So Kapustin and Witten study categories of brains. So what are the brains? There are different ways to think about this, but the sort of shortcut is to think about boundary conditions in this two-dimensional theory. So remember, we are really studying maps from a Riemann surface sigma to this moduli space. Sigma has kind of been a forgotten hero in this story up to now, right? Because we were focusing on the target manifold. But sigma is important too, and nothing can prevent us from considering sigma as a two-dimensional manifold with a boundary. So for instance, we can take an upper half plane, so there's a boundary, we have a cylinder with a boundary, something like this. And so then, in quantum theory, as we already discussed, various quantities are obtained as path integrals, as integrals over the space of maps. And this sort of makes sense if you are considering maps from a compact surface, a compact object. But considering an object with a boundary introduces an additional complication. Have to impose some conditions on the boundary. And the simplest condition on the boundary would be to say, for example, that it lands in a submanifold. So you are considering maps like this. So for example, you can put some constraints, kind of a Dirichlet boundary condition, by saying that the image of the boundary of d sigma should land in some submanifold Y. In inside here. Okay? And then in addition, you can also couple the theory to a one-dimensional theory defined on the boundary. For instance, you can take consider the submanifold together with a bundle with a connection. And then what you can do is you can integrate this connection over your boundary. Some quantity of this kind. And so, okay, so there are many possibilities, but we are in a topological theory, so it means that we have the supercharge, and we only consider things which are preserved by the supersymmetry generated by this charge. So this imposes some conditions on what we can do to still be within the framework of the topological theory. And so in this particular case, when we are considering a B model, I recall that on the Langlands dual side, we're considering a B model in which with respect to the complex structure J, one can show that the condition is that Y should be a complex submanifold, holomorphic, complex submanifold. And then additional data that you can consider on it is a holomorphic metabundle. So that these are the basic brains, so to speak, the basic boundary conditions. And then physicists realize that actually to do justice to this discussion, one should consider sort of a derived category which is generated by such objects. And so what you end up with is just a derived category of coherent shapes on this motion aspect. And this is what they call B brains. So B brains are objects in the derived category. Category of coherent shapes on this motion space with respect to the complex structure chain, because that's the one which is relevant to our theory. So that's B brains. These are the brains. So you get a category of brains on the left hand side of the correspondence. What about the right hand side? Right hand side, we have the A model. And so the corresponding objects, not surprisingly, are called A brains. And so eight brains are boundary conditions. The simplest example of this boundary condition would be that the boundary lands in the submanifold, which is Lagrangian, with respect to the symplectic structure, which defines the same model. So it's totally different setup, right? Instead of complex submanifold, well, that's natural, because the B model depends on a complex structure. So the natural submanifolds are complex submanifolds, whereas in the other setting of A model, it depends on the symplectic structure. So natural submanifolds are Lagrangian submanifolds. So it has to land in the Lagrangian, and then the additional datum that you can have, for example, is a flat unitary. It's a flat unitary vector bundle. Objects of this kind actually have been studied by mathematicians under the name of objects of the Pukai category. So whereas the category of B brains is essentially the derived category of coherent shapes on your label, the category of A brains. A brains are essentially the objects of a category of A brains is essentially the Foucault category. So examples of objects here are pairs, a Lagrangian submanifold, Lagrangian, let me call it L together with a flat unitary bundle. So I use curly L to define line bundle. This is Lagrangian submanifold. And then you have a flat unitary line bundle, say, or a vector bundle in general. And a V vector. Okay. But these are not all objects, actually. So physicists realized later, especially Kapustin and Orlov, realize that actually you can there are boundary conditions preserved by supersymmetry, which are not necessarily supported on Lagrangian submanifolds, but supported on coisotropic submanifolds. So in fact, Kapustin and Whitney have argued that it's important to include all of them in this picture. So you get a certain enlargement of the Foucault category. In addition to Lagrangian brains, you also have get some coisotropic brains with additional structures, which are essentially vector bundles with unitary connections, not flat anymore, but with curvature, which is tightly controlled. Okay, so The mirror symmetry then between these two models, which I recall can be traced back to S-duality of the four-dimensional theories, should then imply the equivalence between the categories of brains associated to the two theories. On the one side, you will have the category of B brains on MH of LG with respect to the complex structure J. And on the other side, you will have the category of A brains on the Hitchin modular space for G, but now viewed with respect to symplectic structure, which I called omega k. This equivalence of categories should be viewed as a special case of one of the corollaries of the mirror symmetry between the two theories. But in fact, in this context, this was originally proposed by Koncevich. Even before physicists got interested in studying this brains under the name homological mirror symmetry. So what this really is a homological mirror symmetry of Koncevich for these two moduli spaces with respect to this data. Equivalence between B brains and A brains. And so now finally we're getting to the punchline, because our quest here was to understand the link between the geometric Langlands correspondence and the S-duality, right? And so now the mirror symmetry appears as a proxy for S-duality, because this is what we get when we reduce from four dimensions to two dimensions. So how can we, and one of the corollaries of this is the equivalence of categories. And now let me remind you that in our previous discussion, we have also encountered an equivalence of categories, a conjectural equivalence of categories, relevant to the geometric Langlands correspondence, in which the Langlands dual group also appears. And so in our discussion, our previous discussion, we had equivalence between the category of all modules on the moduli stack of flat LG bundles, right? And we also had the category of D modules on bund G. Between them is what we call the categorical form of the Langlands correspondence. Right? So the idea of Kapustin-Witten is that there is a link between this equivalence, which is the geometric Langlands correspondence, mathematical geometric Langlands correspondence, and this equivalence, which expresses a kind of Langlands duality or S-duality or mirror symmetry of some quantum field theories. So how does this link work? What's the connection between the two? Well, first of all, on this side, we notice that these categories are almost the same, right? Because this moduli space in the complex structure J is precisely the moduli of flat LG bundles. The only difference is that here we consider the algebraic stack whereas here we're considering the moduli space of semi-stable ones, right, or semi-simple ones. But they're very closely related. And B brains, as I just said, are coherent sheaves, which are the same as O modules, right? So on the left-hand side of the correspondence of the equivalence, the two categories are very close to each other. The difference essentially is that this is a stack in an algebraic variety. There is actually one more subtle point, which has not been sufficiently studied, but probably is important, which is that in physics, what naturally appears are O modules in the analytic topology, not in the risky topology. And so there is also this discrepancy, because naturally, if we think of things in the context of algebraic geometry, we want coherent sheaves in the risky topology, whereas what comes out naturally are sheaves in the analytic topology. So there are a couple of discrepancies between the two descriptions, but they're sort of close enough. In the first approximation, they're very close to each other. But what about this? Here, we seem to be getting objects of entirely different nature. Here we get D modules on bund G. And here we get this exotic A brains. right? And so this actually led Kapustin and Witten to speculate that these two categories should be equivalent, and that this equivalence should have nothing to do with either mirror symmetry or blind lines. And it should be a much more general statement about D modules and A brains. Because we have to remember that MH of G is almost the cotangent bundle on G. Right? If we again modulo the stability conditions. And so Kapustin Witten actually speculated that there should be a parallel equivalence whenever you have, say, a manifold Z, let's say an algebraic variety Z, and D modules on Z on one hand, and you consider A braids on its cotangent bundle. So Kapustin Witten have suggested what naturally comes out of this picture, if you think about it. Well, you have there's two equivalences for the picture to be consistent. There has to be some connection between the categories on the right-hand side. And this is very non-trivial. The point is that these are objects on the cotangent bundle, these are objects on the manifold itself. But of course, it's not very surprising, because we know, for example, that if you have a D module, you can attach to it what's called a singular support. Consider the sort of system of differential equations which define your D module, and you take their symbols. The symbols are functions on the cotangent bundle. And of course, we know very well that differential operators are can be obtained, the algebra differential operators can be thought of as a deformation of the algebra functions on the cotangent bundle. Right? And so there is a way, there's a standard way to attach a Lagrangian submanifold here to a D module, which is called a singular support. Lagrangian in the case of holonomic D module, quasi-tropic in general. But it's not an A braid, it's going to be a conical one, it's going to be singular. So what this construction does, it kind of smoothens it out. So the A brain is kind of a smoothening of that singular support. And so this idea was actually taken by Nadler and Zaslow further, and they actually obtained a mathematical theorem which links this kind of categories with somewhat different setting. For example, instead of D modules, they consider categories of perverse sheaves, derived categories of perverse sheaves. And A brains satisfy certain conditions. But it's remarkable that already, so soon after this idea came around. And of course, this idea kind of was floating before, but it really, as I understand, really after this work of Kapustin and Witten, that people really started to believe that some general, very general result like this should be true. So very soon after this, we already have some very precise and very rigorous mathematical theorems which establish this kind of equivalence. Even if they do not necessarily, there are still many questions that remain in this particular context. For example, because it's not in equivalence. But this, in the first approximation, this is the reason. This is this other equivalence, which I kind of call micro-localization, kind of deformed micro-localization. And again, like I said, many mathematicians like Kashivar and Shapira and many others over the years, they have studied very similar structures. So what we have here then is a kind of a triangle of categories, if we really think of this as one and the same, B brains being all modules. Really a triangle of categories. On one side of the triangle is a categorical Langlands correspondence that we want to understand in mathematics. Another side is the homological mirror symmetry, which actually falls out of S-duality by dimensional reduction. And the third one has to do with microlocalization, passing from the moduli of G bundles to the moduli of Higgs bundles. And that's the way Kapustin and Witten were able to relate S-duality, four-dimensional super-Young Mills, and the geometric Langlands correspondence. Now, the way I presented this, it may sound like all the problems have been solved, but in fact, I have already indicated some of the important issues which have not been addressed or have not been resolved, like, for instance, the discrepancies between these categories, or also discrepancies between these two categories. But actually, there are other problems which go beyond this, and the main reason is, the main problem is that as Kapustin and Witten explained, mirror symmetry of the Hitchin moduli spaces is really the first approximation to S-duality. Four-dimensional theory, of course, super-Young Mills, is a much more complicated theory than two-dimensional signal model. So by reducing from four dimensions to two, we are inevitably losing some information. So roughly speaking, it is the four-dimensional S-duality that should be kind of equivalent to the mathematical Langlands correspondence, even though it is in four dimensions. But it is that as duality that probably knows everything about, there is to know about the language correspondence. It's just the question is how do we extract this information from it. So here, by passing to two dimensions, Kapustin and Wittenberg were able to extract some information by looking at the characters of brain. But remember the derivation, which I talked about how we got those moduli spaces in the first place, right? We were talking about this partial differential equations which show up. And then we were treating the degrees of freedom along sigma, along the second Riemann surface, as the slow ones. This is a good approximation to this limit when we avoid singularities. That we're kind of moving slowly along sigma, and the other variables are fast variables. So then we get the describe those configurations of four-dimensional theory by maps from sigma to the topological BPS configuration of the two-dimensional theory, right? But at singularities, it may well be that the slow variables become fast. You sort of fall into those rabbit holes, you know, unexpectedly. And so that approximation breaks down. And so the next big question then is, what do we do around the singular points? And a lot of work has already been done. So for instance, in my joint work with Witten, we have studied the orbifold singularities, the milder singularities of this moduli space. And we have connected this to the very important phenomenon in the geometric Langlands, which is called the endoscopy. I talked very briefly about it in one of my earlier lectures. And there are further works by Kajota and Witten, for example, in which they also approach the question of what happens at more severe singularities. But so this is just to say that this subject is very, very much wide open. There are many open questions. So I hope that some of you will actually take up those questions in the near future. But in the meantime, my time is up. And so I just wanted to thank you once again for being such a great audience. And thanks for your attention. Thanks for your time.